Hi again. I'm Matt Yurgelun, and I'm the director of the Lynch Syndrome Center here at Dana-Farber. And I'll be talking about gene-to-gene variability in Lynch syndrome. My colleague, Dr. Biller, is unfortunately unable to give the talk today, so I'll be standing in for her. So my disclosures are as seen here. So just as a brief outline, I'll start with a couple of cases, a couple of hypothetical patients, just to highlight some of where some of these patient-specific factors and gene-to-gene-specific factors come into play. Talking about what we know as far as individualized factors that influence cancer risk in people with Lynch syndrome. Talk about where some of the scientific data are as far as how we might be able to screen and surveil people for some of these less common cancers. And then I'll go through some of at least how I practice for the most part in day-to-day care. So here's one case. This is a 27-year-old female, no personal history of cancer. This is how we draw out our pedigrees typically. This is her. These are her parents. Her father had cancer of the ureter at age 44 and colon cancer at age 47 and then passed away at age 48. Her aunt has the same MSH2 alteration, had young onset colon cancer, currently alive at age 58. And her grandmother had uterine cancer, two separate colon cancers, followed by pancreatic cancer and died at age 75. So what would we estimate to be the future risks of cancer for this individual? What should she be screened for and when and how? And maybe more relevantly, what specific factors, what patient-specific factors influence her risk of cancer in the setting of Lynch syndrome? And then what if we change this? What if it's a 27-year-old woman instead with a PMS2 alteration, not MSH2, where maybe the family history is a little bit more subtle, her father having colon cancer, but maybe not the ureter cancer. Same thing, her mother having a breast cancer or pancreatic cancer, but not the other cancers, and her aunt having a history of breast cancer. How much does the specific gene in question influence the magnitude of risk and the spectrum of risk that we see in Lynch syndrome? And does family history play a role in how we assess risk? So as far as some basics of Lynch syndrome, you know, there's a wide list, a wide spectrum, a long list of cancers that we historically have linked to Lynch syndrome. And honestly, that list seems to be growing as we understand things a bit better. But it's not one size fits all. Back in the old days, this paper is from 2012, only 10 years ago, we really lumped things all together. We would call it all Lynch syndrome, regardless of what gene we were looking at. And for the most part, it was kind of a throw the kitchen sink at it type of approach. There was a list of screening that we put people through, really regardless of the gene in question, oftentimes regardless of the family history. And it's a lot of screening. And I think what's become clear is that there really are patient-specific factors that influence risks of some of these specific cancers. This throw the kitchen sink at it type of approach really is overkill for many people with Lynch syndrome. And the reality is most screening for some of these less common cancers is actually of questionable benefit. I highlighted here the things that actually have proven benefit. The ones in blue proven to reduce incidence of cancer, hysterectomy and removal of the ovaries for female Lynch carriers, and daily aspirin. And in pink is the only one that's actually proven to reduce cancer incidence and mortality, to actually proven to reduce somebody's chances of dying, and that's colonoscopies. The rest of these are all things that we think are helpful. We hope they're helpful, but they're actually not proven to reduce cancer risk or to save lives. So what influences somebody's risk of specific Lynch cancers? Well, I would argue that there are non-modifiable risk factors, things you can't really change about yourself, your biologic sex, age, the Lynch gene in question, your family history. And then there are things that you can control, modifiable factors. Do you actually pursue various types of screening or maybe risk-reducing surgery? Are the medications that you're taking, such as aspirin, somebody's lifestyle, other environmental factors? And I'll get into some of these specifics. So gene-specific considerations, some of these statistics I took from a multinational database called the Prospective Lynch Syndrome Database, which comes from our colleagues in Europe. MLH1-associated Lynch syndrome, we typically would classify as being high penetrance, meaning high risks for cancer. From some of the PLSD data, they demonstrated that individuals with MLH1-associated Lynch syndrome have a lifetime likelihood of any Lynch cancer in the 70 to 80% range. In particular, the risks of GI cancers are high, especially for males. High risk of colorectal cancer, not surprisingly, but I would say particularly a high risk of upper GI tract cancers. So cancers of the stomach, the pancreas, the bile ducts, and upper small intestine, which seems to be more pronounced for male carriers than for females. Contrast this with MSH2, which is also a high penetrance syndrome, meaning high lifetime risk of any Lynch cancers. But what's curious about MSH2, I would say disproportionately to the other Lynch genes, there's a particularly high risk of urinary tract cancers in MSH2 associated Lynch syndrome, especially for male carriers, with a lifetime likelihood somewhere in the 15 to 20% range. And I would emphasize that with MSH2, the spectrum of cancers that we seem to see seems to be the widest for MSH2 than for the other genes, with increased lifetime risks of cancers of the upper GI tract, as well as the large intestine, the gynecologic tract, uterus and ovaries, as I mentioned, the urinary tract. MSH2 is where we most commonly see some of the skin manifestations of Lynch syndrome, so-called Muir-Torre syndrome, with sebaceous adenomas or sebaceous carcinomas of the skin. Rarely you can see sarcomas. It's certainly the gene where we see the widest spectrum of risk. EpCAM is a relatively rare form of Lynch syndrome. As such, we don't have a ton of data. We know that there's a high lifetime risk of colorectal cancer. The way EpCAM works, it shares a lot of overlap genetically with MSH2. And so we tend to assume that it's got overlap with how MSH2 associated Lynch syndrome manifests, but we really don't necessarily have data to actually confirm that outside the colorectal cancer risk. MSH6 associated Lynch syndrome. So I think we've often called this a relatively mild form of Lynch syndrome, and that's true as it relates to risks of GI tract cancers and urinary cancers. Colorectal cancer, for example, the lifetime risk actually seems to be relatively modest compared to MLH1 and MSH2. Where it's not so true, however, is the risk of gynecologic cancers. The lifetime risk here is about 40% for uterine cancer, a little more than 10% for ovarian cancer. And these are really on par to what we see with MLH1 and MSH2. So it's a little missing the mark to say that MSH6 is a milder form of Lynch syndrome. It really depends on what organ system you're looking at here. And then PMS2 is the one that's probably the biggest outlier. We call this low penetrance, or at least low to moderate penetrance, meaning it's a much more modest lifetime likelihood of getting any Lynch-associated cancer. Some recent data would suggest that there may only be increased risks of colorectal and endometrial cancers, and that the longer list of other Lynch syndrome cancers, ovarian cancer, upper GI tract cancer, urinary tract cancers, et cetera, that these are cancers that you might not see any more commonly in people with PMS2 associated Lynch syndrome than you would for the average population. All of this is still stuff that's coming into focus. So I wouldn't claim that we know any of this definitively, but recent data have suggested that the risks of colorectal cancer and endometrial cancer are certainly real. The other Lynch cancers, the risk seems to be extremely mild and perhaps not elevated whatsoever. I would encourage you to check out, there's two free online calculators. These are both designed to be used more so by healthcare providers, but I think savvy patients can figure this out pretty well as well. One is from the PLSD, the multinational registry I mentioned. One was developed by our colleagues at the Harvard School of Public Health. You basically input the gene in question, somebody's biologic sex, their age, and it spits out a future likelihood of various cancers based on the data. Ask2Me is nice, especially because it factors in whether somebody's had prior risk-reducing surgery, such as a hysterectomy, in these various risks. So, okay, shifting gears for a second, what about family history? Does family history actually play into how we screen somebody, or should it play into how we screen somebody? Various guidelines that we use to tell us how to practice do recommend that we use family history to guide screening for some of these less common cancers in Lynch syndrome. You know, anecdotally, I think we would say we certainly see families that seem to have clustering of certain types of cancer. It's not clear, though, is that actually driven by the gene-specific risks, or is that because there are specific factors? We put out a study, my colleague Dr. Biller led this study just last year, looking at this, and the punchline was that at least for these less common cancers, urinary tract cancers, small bowel cancers, sebaceous cancers of the skin or sebaceous adenomas, stomach cancer, pancreatic and biliary cancer, that for every affected relative in the family, for every close relative who had one of these cancers, somebody's own risk was incrementally increased. And this was while we statistically controlled for some of these other factors like age, sex, and the gene in question. So it does seem that family history, independent of the gene in question, does seem to have an influence on somebody's cancer risk, at least for these less common cancers. Now, why that is still remains a question. It may be that there's other shared genetic factors, shared lifestyle factors, or shared exposures. We don't really know. But to sum up, it certainly seems that patient-specific risk factors very much do influence an individual's own risk of various Lynch cancers. So it's really not one size fits all. And therefore, our management shouldn't be one size fits all. The gene in question has a huge role in this. As I mentioned, MLH1 and MSH2 being high penetrance kind of across the board, although still different from one another. MSH6 having a little bit of an attenuated risk of GI tract cancers, but the gynecologic cancer risk is plenty high. PMS2 certainly has a very attenuated risk and may have a narrower spectrum of risk than the other Lynch genes, but certainly does raise the risk for colorectal and uterine cancer. And then EpCAM is one where we certainly need more data, though for the time being, we mostly presume it to be similar to MSH2. Sex plays a role. Across the board, we see that males have higher risks for GI tract cancers and urinary tract cancers. And from our data and others, there really are just emerging data about how family history may in and of itself also influence somebody's risk. And exactly why that is, you know, remains to be determined, but these are things we would love to understand better. So some of the maybe new kids on the block, or at least cancers where I would argue that there's sometimes some misunderstandings about whether or not these are truly Lynch cancers. Kidney cancer is one that historically has been linked to Lynch syndrome. This has always been a little tricky to tease out because, you know, so much of the data that are out there come from registries where people have reported their family history rather than cases where we're actually analyzing the tumors themselves, sequencing the tumors, which is really what we do in modern day science and modern day practice. And when people say kidney cancer, they might be referring to what we call renal cell cancer or renal cell carcinoma, or they could be referring to cancers of the upper ureter. The ureter is the tube that connects the kidneys to the bladder. We know that Lynch syndrome, especially MSH2 related Lynch syndrome, raises the risk for cancers of the ureter. And it's been a little unclear in the literature whether that is the source of the link to kidney cancer or if true renal cell cancers are part of the Lynch syndrome spectrum. What we are seeing as we study these more now tumor sequencing, we're seeing that the vast majority of true renal cell cancers have biology that we call microsatellite stable or mismatch repair proficient, which usually argues that these are not Lynch syndrome related cancers. But for an individual person or an individual family, this may differ. But so the link between Lynch syndrome and kidney cancer remains one that's a bit nuanced, I would say. Breast cancer is another one where a few years ago, there were a number of headlines essentially proclaiming Lynch syndrome causes breast cancer. And that was all in the context of genetic testing becoming quicker, cheaper, easier, especially to do these new multi-gene panels where people are tested for dozens of different cancer genes in parallel. And what we found is more and more women with breast cancer in particular were undergoing genetic testing. We stumbled upon more Lynch syndrome than we realized. But I think a lot of that had to do with the fact that Lynch syndrome is more common than we previously realized. When you look at the tumor tissue itself from most cases of female breast cancer, again, the vast majority are microsatellite stable, mismatch repair proficient, arguing that those ones at the very least are probably not caused by somebody's Lynch syndrome. It's possible for somebody with Lynch syndrome to get a cancer that actually has nothing to do with their Lynch syndrome. And so there, right now, I would say that the data are actually conflicting at best, as to whether or not there truly is an increased risk of breast cancer in female Lynch syndrome carriers. There's certainly no evidence that females with Lynch syndrome develop breast cancer younger than the average population. And this factors into what we recommend as far as screening and prevention. Other cancers that are, I would say, somewhat newly linked to Lynch syndrome, we've been wondering about prostate cancer for a number of years now. And it's a similar situation to breast cancer because it's just such a common cancer. It's always been a little tough to tease out what's cause and what's effect, what's the chicken and what's the egg. Recent data, though, would I think pretty conclusively suggest that there truly is an increased risk for prostate cancer in men with Lynch syndrome, at least men with MLH1, MSH2, or MSH6 associated Lynch syndrome, although it is a mildly increased risk. And I'll get into how that maybe plays into screening. And then lastly, just to mention it, sarcomas, these are rare cancers. These are cancers of the soft tissue, can be the bones, the cartilage, the muscles. These are rare, rare cancers, but recent data have, I think, in my mind, conclusively demonstrated that there is an increased risk of these cancers in Lynch syndrome, but you know, still quite rare. Less than 1% of individuals by age 75 will have a sarcoma in the context of Lynch syndrome. And again, this is one where we see the vast majority of diagnoses specifically in MSH2 carriers for whatever reason. So how can we personalize Lynch syndrome management? As I mean, this is the same list I showed before. If throwing the kitchen sink at it is overkill, how do we figure out who needs what as far as some of these targeted screenings? So I will start off by mentioning one piece that's not actually screening, but where I think we can personalize our use of this. Aspirin is something that people have heard about, certainly if they've come to our prior LinkedIn conferences. The CAP2 study put this on the map, looking at daily aspirin versus a daily placebo in people with Lynch syndrome. And the punchline was that people taking daily aspirin for at least 2 years had more than 40% fewer colorectal cancers than people taking the placebo. The benefit was delayed. It wasn't until at least 5 years after starting this that people started to see some degree of prevention statistically. But all it took was 25 Lynch patients taking daily aspirin to prevent one colorectal cancer. That's a pretty impressively low number as far as prevention studies go. What we don't know is if there's an optimal dose. The dose used in CAP2 is actually particularly high, 600 milligrams per day. The CAP3 study, which is a follow-up study, is in follow-up right now. We expect to have data on this within about 3 to 4 years as to whether or not there's a difference in outcomes when Lynch patients take different doses of aspirin. My own approach to using aspirin in Lynch syndrome, this is not based on data, this is just my approach. I try to risk stratify what that person's future risk of colorectal cancer is. I might think about higher dosing, maybe like 325 daily, for those who have high future risks of colorectal cancer. So young people who have, you know, 40, 50 plus years of life in front of them, especially those with MLH1 or MSH2 associated Lynch syndrome and a fully intact large intestine. I might use more medium dosing, say 2 baby aspirin a day for most other individuals with Lynch syndrome who might have more of a medium risk of colorectal cancer. And then a low dose of aspirin, 81 milligrams a day, or no aspirin for those who have relatively low future risks of colorectal cancer. So people who are older, who maybe have just fewer years of life in front of them, people with PMS2 associated Lynch syndrome, or people who have had a large portion of their large intestine removed in the past. And then certainly I don't recommend aspirin for those who have significant risks of complications and or those who just simply have no large bowel tissue left. Older individuals, people using other blood thinners, people who have a history of GI bleeding or ulcers, allergies, people with uncontrolled high blood pressure, people who might be at risk for some of these complications. We usually want people to avoid aspirin during the early trimesters of a pregnancy unless otherwise advised by their obstetrician. And certainly I would emphasize, talk to your doctor before starting this. Don't just start this based off of what we're talking about today. Now, surveillance for some of the less common Lynch cancers, I want to go through some recent data on some of these cancers. We'll start with gastric cancer, stomach cancer, and Lynch syndrome. For the longest time, we've said that we really don't have much data about how effective this surveillance is, but I would point out some recently published data from our colleagues in Germany who looked at over 1,000 individuals with Lynch syndrome undergoing an upper endoscopy, what we call an EGD. They found over time amongst these 1,100 individuals, 49 gastric cancers, 49 stomach cancers, all of which were in people with MLH1 or MSH2 alterations. And what was impressive here is that people who had stomach cancer found on screening, they had no symptoms, they were just undergoing screening, those 83% of those were stage one. And contrast that with people who maybe weren't getting regularly screened but showed up with symptoms, only 25% of those were stage one. And so this suggests that with routine screening, you really can find these cancers at an earlier stage. Our colleagues across town at Mass General Hospital recently published as well that the majority of Lynch syndrome stomach cancers that we see, these individuals often had other findings in the non-cancerous portion of their stomach, including findings of chronic gastritis, autoimmune gastritis. These are types of inflammation. We also think that factors like H. pylori, which is a type of bacteria, or intestinal metaplasia are other things you can find on biopsy of the stomach lining that could hint that somebody might have a somewhat increased risk for stomach cancer. Pancreatic cancer surveillance, this is one that's, there's a lot of new information now. Some people may have participated in the CAPS-5 study, which we've been participating in for a number of years. This is looking at yearly screening of the pancreas using a type of MRI called an MRCP and or a type of endoscopy called an EUS, an endoscopic ultrasound, where it's an upper endoscopy, but at the tip of that scope, there's an ultrasound of the pancreas that's done through the wall of the stomach and the small intestine. So the recent publication from this CAPS consortium looked at over 1,700 individuals undergoing this type of pancreatic cancer screening, which included people with Lynch syndrome, although they made up only a small fraction of individuals in this study. And the punchline was that you found one pancreatic cancer per year for every 194 individuals you screened, which is actually a pretty impressive number to me. I would have expected you'd need to screen more people. But what was most impressive was that those people who had screen-detected pancreatic cancers, meaning their cancer was found only because they were getting this screening, that they were disproportionately stage one, and that they had a 73% chance of being alive at 5 years. That's unheard of for pancreatic cancer. I would point out that none of these pancreatic cancers, at least in this study, were people with Lynch syndrome. But again, that's probably owing to the fact that they made up a small fraction of the population. And you contrast that to people who were in the study but were not following through with their screening and were diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, as unfortunately we see too often, almost all of these were stage four cancers and none of these individuals were alive 5 years later. And so this just shows that graphically, again, disproportionately stage one in those undergoing screening, disproportionately stage four in those who are not. This is really showing us that, you know, pancreatic cancer surveillance for certain high-risk individuals really can have benefit. But I caution that it's actually this type of screening is also very good at finding things other than cancer. 30 to 40% of people have some sort of abnormality in their pancreas, most commonly cysts, but this really runs the risk of potentially over-treatment, false positives. Most of these don't require biopsy or other intervention, but interpreting this can be pretty nuanced. And so I really do emphasize that people getting pancreatic cancer surveillance really should do so with providers and at centers that are experienced with a lot of these nuances. Otherwise, I think we really run the risk of doing harm. I would also say that it's unknown if there are benefits to this type of surveillance in people with Lynch syndrome who lack a family history. We really need to understand that better. Lastly, I want to say a word about urinary tract cancer screening in Lynch syndrome. This is a relatively old study, but still important. This is from Denmark, where they looked at 1,800 plus urine cytology specimens. Somebody pees into a cup and you look for cancer cells or abnormal cells. This encompassed almost 1,000 individuals with Lynch syndrome. When doing this, they only found 2 urinary tract cancers in people who lacked symptoms. Contrast that with 22 false positives, people who had abnormal screening but ended up not having cancer. And then in addition to this, there were a number of people who were actually diagnosed with urinary tract cancer anyways, including 5 people who were diagnosed after having normal urine cytology, showing us that this might be a rather useless test, unfortunately. And then more recently, our colleagues from the Cleveland Clinic, a smaller study, but they looked at over 200 people with Lynch syndrome who were undergoing urinalysis, basically just a dipstick to look for microscopic blood in the urine. 9% of these individuals did have microscopic blood. All of them underwent a cystoscopy, which is a scope that goes into the bladder to look around, and all of them were normal. Contrast that with the fact that 5 of these individuals still were ultimately diagnosed with urinary tract cancer, even though they had prior normal screening. Again, suggesting that the yield of this screening is not so good and the false positive rate is rather high. So my own practice for screening for some of these less common Lynch cancers, for stomach and duodenal cancer screening, I usually do a baseline upper endoscopy by age 30 and try to biopsy for H. pylori or chronic gastritis or intestinal metaplasia, at least at baseline, and usually repeat that 3 to 5 years later. Individuals where we might do that more frequently, say every 1 to 2 years, would be people who had some of these findings on biopsy, people who had a prior cancer or a precancerous polyp in their own upper GI tract or have a family history of such. Screening for the lower small bowel, we sometimes will think about video capsule endoscopy, a pill camera, if you will, but there really are no data about that having much benefit. These other cancers are actually quite uncommon, so we'll consider this in people who have their own history or a strong family history of small bowel cancer, but it's still probably low yield there, and I honestly don't do this for very many people. For pancreatic cancer screening, which probably can include bile duct screening as well, at this time I would say there's no role for surveillance in most individuals unless there's a family history. If there is a family history, I'll typically recommend annual screening with an MRCP and or the endoscopic ultrasound, usually starting at age 50 or 10 years younger than the youngest diagnosis in the family, but with a significant amount of counseling about the risks of some of these incidental findings and with emphasis that this really needs to be done in high volume centers. For urinary tract cancers, again, I don't screen most individuals. I do try to counsel people on the importance of looking for blood in the urine and reporting that, even if it happens just once. I'll think about a urinalysis usually beginning in the early 30s for people who are MSH2 positive because of the significant link there, and or people with a significant family history, but I do emphasize the risk of false positives. And at this time, we don't know of any role for imaging, whether it's CT, MRI, ultrasound, or cystoscopy, although we will consider this in people who've had their own history of urinary tract cancer. Prostate cancer, as I mentioned before, kind of a new kid on the block as far as cancers that we screen for. I'll consider screening with a PSA blood test, usually starting at age 40. Contrast that with age 50, which is what we do for average risk individuals. And as far as breast cancer screening, I would say we really only increase the screening if it's warranted by other factors, such as their own history or a strong family history of breast cancer. Certainly no role for risk-reducing prophylactic surgery, such as mastectomy. Skin tumors, these sebaceous adenomas that I mentioned before, we have no data how to screen for these or who should be screened, but the risks of a full body skin exam with a dermatologist are essentially nil. So I do usually recommend that most Lynch carriers see a dermatologist for a full body skin exam at least once yearly, especially if they've got a personal or family history of some of these sebaceous skin tumors. And screening for things like brain cancer, unfortunately, we really have no data. Probably very low yield, even if there is a family history. We need better screening there, but fortunately, it's a rare manifestation of Lynch syndrome. So in summary, the cancer risks in Lynch syndrome are really not one size fits all. These are five different genes and essentially five different syndromes, even if they are related syndromes. We're learning more about the gene and sex-specific differences in the risk and how familial burden and family history plays into this. And again, I would emphasize some of these free online tools can help somebody understand their own personalized risks, emphasizing that these are just risks and probabilities and not certainties. So happy to take questions, and thanks so much.